John Stith Pemberton was born on July 8, 1831, in Knoxville, Georgia, and raised in Rome, Georgia, to James Pemberton and Martha Gant. By the age of 19, he earned a medical degree and was granted his license to practice Thompsonian medicine. He later opened a business known as Materia Medica, where substances would be used to make medical remedies. Years later, he further pursued a graduate degree in pharmacy at the Medical College of Georgia in Augusta, Georgia. He was married to Anne Clifford in 1853 and had their only child, Charles Pemberton, in 1854. But he laid his white coat down and took up a button uniform when the Civil War began, where he ranked as first lieutenant. 3 years fighting the battle in 1865, he was injured when slashed with a saber. With an injury like this, his doctors didn't believe he would live to see another day, so they gave him morphine to ease the pain he was feeling as he transitioned to the afterlife. Though, despite the doubts, he recovered. In public, he was praised, but in private, he was struggling. He suffered from morphine addiction. He heard that a drink, Vin Mariani, could cure any ail. The idea of creating his own drink to him would solve his addiction along with anxiety, depression, and other ailments. His ingredients included coca leaves, red wine, and cola nuts, and he called it Pemberton's French Wine Cola. He not only wanted to benefit himself, but other veterans, so he would have a distribution network that would sell his product. He made the syrup in his lab and shipped it to partners and contractors who would sell it as they wished. Though it was in popular demand, it was even to keep the business afloat. In 1885, his drink hit the market, but then Atlanta announced the banning of alcohol. He, of course, feared his wine would be a part of that pack, so he hurriedly came up with a new formula to prevent this. He removed the wine, but the cola nuts made it too bitter to drink, so he replaced it with synthetic caffeine, added sugar, citric acid, vanilla, lemon oil, orange, nutmeg, and coriander extract. His bookkeeper, Frank Robinson, was the one who suggested he rename the drink Coca-Cola, but with two C's, explaining it would be more eye-catching to consumers. He launched the new and improved remedy in 1886, but sales were only topped off to $50 and sunk even more because supplies cost $70. John saw this as a loss, but Frank saw it as a winning lesson to try again, he said. The loss was to be expected since the business was new. Frank came up with the idea to market the product using banners, streetcar placards, and store awnings. This was a risk, but in the end, it was worth it. Coca-Cola was now in demand. Coca-Cola continued to be in great demand, but John was diagnosed with stomach cancer and sadly relapsed. He feared his family would be in financial struggle and his addiction worsen, so he decided to sell shares of the business. Despite that, he believed that the drink Coca-Cola would be a national brand one day and kept cheers for his son, Charles Pemberton. Charles was in charge of the manufacturing aspect, but like his father, Charles too had a morphine addiction. Who would run the business now? This worried Frank, so he went ahead and found investors while John remained bedridden. Frank luckily contacted a wealthy and hardworking entrepreneur named Asa Candler, but he didn't think the business was a worthwhile venture. Frank had the same belief as John and said to Candler, "See that wagon going by with all those empty beer kegs? Well, we're going to push Coca-Cola until you see wagons going by with Coca-Cola just like that." Now convinced, Asa bought the rights and formula of the business, then built the company by expanding the sales with pharmacy stores. He also came up with the idea to handle slips of paper, coupons, that could be redeemed with a glass of the drink at soda fountains. John Pemberton died on August 16, 1888, at the age of 57, suffering from poverty and his morphine addiction. He also didn't get to see his vision of the company become a reality. 6 years later, his son died as he succumbed to opium addiction. In 1899, two lawyers, Joseph Whitehead and Benjamin Thomas, approached Mr. Candler with the idea to bottle the drink, but he believed the fountains were the future. Bottling was too much expense, and he did not want to be a part of it, but he told the lawyers they could do so by bottling it for $1. That way, if they succeeded, he could sell more syrup, and if they failed, he wouldn't be at a loss. A win-win in his eyes. The lawyers went ahead to search for investors to finance this and built an operation that would bottle Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola became the first franchise business in America, and the popularity of the bottled drink surprised DASA. Since there were so many copycats of the product, the company decided to create Contour bottles. In 1926, the sales of fountain drinks were lesser than the bottled version. Asa Candler resigned in 1916 because he was nominated for mayor of Atlanta, so he gave the company to his children. In 1919, they sold it for $25 million to investors. One of those investors, Ernest Woodruff, took the company public and ensured that the best quality of the product was distributed. He later retired and made his son, Robert Woodruff, the president of the business. Under his leadership, they removed the coca leaves from the formula and launched metal top open coolers in 1929. In 1923, they launched 6 bottle packs, and in 1933, launched automated fountain dispensers. Some bottles were green with gold, similar in look to champagne, and collaborated with many historic events, as it is closely linked with American culture.